Until they know something of the science of the masters, their hypothesis is doubtless the more rational. But the masters are not so limited, as are the physical scientists. Their science is more inclusive. Unlike all others who hold to the vitalistic hypothesis, the masters do not assume the existence of an unknown and unknowable force giving rise to the phenomena of life. They assume nothing. This is not simply an hypothesis for them. They deal with forces which they know. And the masters know that life is due to a force extraneous to matter, and they know that biological phenomena cannot manifest as a resultant of the known laws of matter and energy. On the contrary, these phenomena exist as the direct result of the action of spirit upon matter, through the intermediary action of extremely subtle substances or forces which science has not yet demonstrated. These finer forces are in fact the more refined forms of matter, which up to date have not been demonstrated in the physical laboratory. That mind and spirit play a vital part in every manifestation of life upon this planet is, of course, not yet known to physical science. But it is well known to the masters. Physical science is in no position to deny this fact, so well known to the masters. The masters are able to penetrate into the deeper substrata of nature. They can see the inner workings of all laws and processes. There is not a blade of grass or an insect or an animal which is absolutely devoid of mind and spirit. Furthermore, mind and spirit are the activating forces of all forms of life. Without them both, no living thing could survive for a single moment. When matter is quickened by the all-pervading life-generating mind and spirit, working in harmony, it begins to manifest the phenomena of life. When mind and spirit are withdrawn, life ceases at once and disintegration sets in. All that physical science knows is that life manifests in certain ways. It follows certain well-attested laws. Scientists do not even try to guess the ultimate causes of life. Only the masters, having access to the higher planes of being where the phenomena of both mind and spirit can be seen by them, know that without mind and spirit both, no life can manifest on this physical plane, or on any other plane, where matter is a factor in such manifestation. As a matter of fact, no physical scientist can possibly prove that this is not so. They are simply obliged to say that they know nothing about it then. To support their weakening prestige, they naively assert that no one else can possibly know anything about it. They are loath to allow the assumption of mind and spirit animating nature. But this is no assumption to the masters. As said before, they know. It is just as unscientific to assert that the mechanical laws of matter and energy can produce life as to assert that they cannot. Neither can possibly be proved by the physical scientist working alone. Therefore, one assumption is as good as the other, even from the viewpoint of the theologian, who claims that an unknown and unknowable force does produce life. But, as said before, the masters assume nothing. They speak from perfect knowledge and they know that all biological phenomena on the physical plane of life are due to the interplay of both mind and spirit acting upon matter. The masters know what the oldest and most renowned scientists have always assumed, as the fundamental law of biogenesis. Our masters of the laboratory must not anymore try to squeeze all the cosmos into a test tube. It cannot be done. The spirit is abroad in the daylight, and it must be heard. At the same time, we need not worry lest science shall run away with religion, and bury it in the potter's field. We need not join with Rousseau in an effort to curb scientific thinking for fear it may snatch away our pet god. If they can take the god, let them have it. It is only a rag baby. We have no need to push aside the demands of science to enthrone religion and intuition. Science and religion are no longer enemies. Indeed, the hour is approaching, and now is, when these two angels of light shall meet in mystic union, and then it will be seen that they are not enemies, not even friends, but are one and the same being. And then will dawn the new age, the golden age. That will be the age of reason spoken of by Thomas Paine. And it will be the age of the super science, the period of the super genius, the arrival of the superman. Just as the physiological psychology of James and others can never reduce mind to the materialistic level of brain cells and nerve ganglia, secreting thought, as the liver secretes bile, so the established facts of science can never displace spirit from man, or the universe. The most they can say is that they know nothing about it. Science will eventually be obliged to recognize that spirit is the supreme force in nature, as well as the immortal spark in man himself. When science becomes vitalized by spirit, the age of true science will dawn. But at present, science has no way of demonstrating this fundamental fact of nature, and it is not to be blamed for its limitations. We would only suggest that it avoid dogmatism until the day of its enlightenment. The two currents are now running along side by side, and as men gain in scientific knowledge, a few are beginning to look for the solution of spiritual and religious problems by the scientific method. When the world thinkers adopt the scientific method in religion, both science and religion will experience a new birth. Then it will be seen that all truth is one, its several aspects being but parts of the same radiant being. And this is exactly what the Eastern wisdom is now trying to bring about. As Francis Bacon threw into the sky the torch of science and gathered about its blazing light the whole of thinking Europe, even so the scientific method of the spiritual masters now offers to the world a system which will enable all men to enter the domain of certified knowledge in religion, just as truly as in chemistry or biology. When the masters of physical science shall, at the same time, qualify as spiritual masters, the age of pure science will open up. All spiritual masters are also masters of physical science, but up to the present they have been very few in number, and their own work is very pressing. Besides, the teaching of physical science is not their mission. We believe, however, that the time must come when the spiritual department of science will be considered by all odds the most essential part of the curriculum to be undertaken by the student who aspires to be called a real scientist. Upon this splendid foundation, the new social order will be established. Soul culture and mental culture and physical culture, all working hand in hand, will produce the educated man. Without them all, no man can lay any claim to genuine culture. There must be a resetting of cultural foundations. Political and social ideals are changing. Even ethical standards are not what they were half a century ago. This has led many good people to shiver with dread, lest the future witness the total wreck of civilization. They need not worry. Out of the dying past, a brighter future will spring, enriched by a spiritualized science. The days of the political demagogue are numbered, even in America. The ideal of every dreamer, from the days of Plato down to the last high school boy, has been to establish the social utopia upon the basis of natural science. More and Plato only reflected that which is in the substratum of every thinking brain, viz., that no ideal social order can ever be established until science is made the foundation of government. And this can be done only when the politician and money monger are thrown out of office and men eminent in science are given the reins of government. But even that is not altogether safe and sound as a working policy. Men of brains of scientific trading, experts in all branches of science, each a highly skilled specialist in his own department, must also be morally sound, that is, they must manifest soul as well as intellect. And this will be an accomplished fact just as soon as religion is placed upon a scientific foundation. Not before. That will mean an all-round development of our specialists. When that happy day arrives, such men as aspire to governmental positions first will have to show that they are guided in all essential matters by an enlightened conscience, inspired by an unselfish love. After that, they will qualify in their several departments of science. A government by such experts, call it oligarchy, or what you will, shall constitute the first civilized government of history.